what it be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine.
I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine. Oh, I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak at all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine.
Will I be able to speak it all? I can.
can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I would do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Thank God for the blood. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Well, good evening to you. Good morning to you. God bless you real good today. I pray in Jesus' name that your faith is firm. I pray that your hope is sure. And I pray that you're walking in the love of God. I pray that you have no anger in you. I pray that you are not guilty for something you've done wrong. I pray that you are enjoying rich biblical fellowship with God. And you can do all of the above, brother and sister, because Christ has shed his blood on the cross to give you entry into the presence of the Creator God. In my prayer life, in my prayer time, I should say this morning, I was just blown away in my heart when I began to think about the fact that I have access, and not only myself, but every believer has access to the kingdom of God. We have access to not only the kingdom of God, but we have access to being a part of the very nature of God. And God has provided the weaponry that we need for us to conquer every demon, every devil. We can be healed of the brokenness of our past and have no anxiety about the future nor the present. God has brought forth a perfect salvation. And the only problem is that in the church community, there are so few people who know how to use their faith to claim the rich blessings and favor that God has made abundantly available to you. May I tell you tonight, dear brother and sister, I don't care how you feel, and I don't care what's going on around you. You are loved by God. And I don't have the vocabulary to adequately express the love that God has for you. He so loved you until he was willing to subject himself to death on that old rugged cross, that he may give you life and liberty. So tonight, God, I'm praying in Jesus' name that you would bless your people to have a fresh revelation on Christ. I pray for this entire ministry and anybody who's viewing this today or tonight. I pray in Jesus' name that you, God, would give your people a more pronounced revelation as to who Jesus is, and show us who we are in him on today. And I'd give your name all the praise and glory in Jesus' name. Now anoint me as I teach tonight. Let the Holy Ghost anoint my mind and my spirit that I be able to speak words of life tonight. I be able to cast that demon away from God's people tonight in Jesus' name. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I don't feel no waste time. I've come too far from where I store it from. Nobody told me that the road would be easy. I don't believe he's brought me this far to leave me. Now you got enemies, you got all kind of things going on around you, but don't get tired. I don't feel no waste time. You know why? You know why? I've come too far from where I started from. Nobody told me that the road would be easy. I don't believe he's brought me this far. I don't believe he's brought me this far. I don't believe he's brought me this far to leave me. And I pray that you have the same testimony on tonight. You may be going through a test in your life. The devil may be coming after you. But I want you to run back to that cross. Go back to the cross. Because at the cross, where you first saw the light and the burdens of your heart rolled away, and it was there by faith that you received your sight. And now, you have your all today. God bless you. Amen. We got a couple of musicians in here, and they're steering me on. They need to stop playing so I can go and teach, brother. I feel like an evangelist from East Texas tonight. I feel like putting my hand behind my ear and just squalling tonight. That Jesus. I feel like telling somebody he's able. I said he's able. Is anybody out there viewing today who know that he's able to heal the sick? He's able to deliver the bound. He's able, praise God, to lift your heavy burdens. He's able to make a way out of no way. Ain't he all right? Have you tried Jesus? Have you trusted in his blood? Have you depended on his word? Are you standing on the word under the blood of Jesus? Woo, glory to God. Well, amen, amen. I'm going to stop right there, amen. I'll stop right there. So y'all need to pray for these musicians. They don't want to make me act like this here. So let's get back into it. This is part two of the power that is in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. Power to take authority over every negative issue is in the name of Jesus. Tonight we're going to begin in Isaiah chapter 9, verse number 6. Isaiah 9 and verse number 6. And the Bible says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful." There's a name right there. "And his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace." His name is Wonderful. His name is Counselor. In his name, there is Everlasting Father, and he is the Prince of Peace. And in Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18, and I just want to encourage you to know tonight that, dear hearts, you and I have been authorized to use the name Jesus. That is the calling card. That is the authority name. That name, last week, remember, we talked about that you've been given the power of attorney. In other words, the power of attorney is a person who has been authorized to do business on the behalf of another. And so in this case tonight, as we talk about the name Jesus, dear hearts, I want you to know that you have the power of attorney, that in fact you are on the earth to do business in the name of Jesus. You have been authorized to use that name, and there is, listen, there is salvation in that name. That's the only name you can find salvation in. It's in the name of Jesus. Note here, St. Matthew chapter 1, putting in at verse number 18, 1 and 18. And now the birth of Jesus, now remember Isaiah talked about the name that he was coming. Now in Matthew's, he's here. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on this wise. When as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. In other words, before they consummated their marriage, she was already pregnant, praise God, by the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privately. It was in his mind just to kind of walk away from her and not even tell anybody that the woman that he's to marry is already pregnant. But God got involved. Verse 20, but while he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thy son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary, thy wife. For that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Thou shalt call his name Jesus, Counselor, Wonderful Father. Thou shalt call his name Jesus, the Wonderful One, the Savior, the Healer, the Deliverer, the Son of the True and Living God. Call his name Jesus, because he's going to save his people from their sin. And this is the name that we deal with tonight. This is the name that we call on when we know we've gotten ourselves in a mess. In St. Matthew's 12 chapter, and verse number 21, the Bible says, and in his name shall the Gentiles trust. The Gentiles, non-Jews, in his name shall we trust. And I want to remind you tonight, as we deal with the name Jesus, that the reason why you have salvation tonight isn't because you've been so nice. The reason that you have salvation tonight isn't because you've never made a mistake. The reason you have salvation tonight isn't because you're so insightful and so committed and so dedicated to God. No, you have salvation tonight because of the name of Jesus. Salvation is in the name of Jesus, and no other name except in the name of Jesus. Acts chapter 4. And I think it's so important, dear hearts, that we remember that, because it's so easy to point fingers at everybody else, and it is so easy to find something wrong with everybody except yourself. But I want you to know that none of us, including the apostles and the bishops and the elders and whomever, nobody, absolutely nobody is saved because of their own effort. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourself. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And I'll tell you, one of the things that Satan does is that he desires to dislodge you from your hope. And once you don't hope in Christ, then you're going to look around and try to find somebody to compete with, or to find somebody to compare with, or find somebody to find something wrong with them. But the whole problem is there's something wrong with you. Because when you keep your eyes on Jesus, and when you continue to trust in his blood and to depend on the power of Holy Ghost and stand in agreement with the word of God in the name of Jesus, not only can you have salvation on paper, but you can live it, dear brother, dear sister. I want to tell somebody tonight, God forgives you for whatever you've done wrong. He forgives you, but he needs you to accept it and start staying close to God and allow Jesus not only to be your Savior, but allow him to be your Lord and your Master. The book of Acts chapter 4, verse number 12, this is after they had been upset with Peter and John because they had healed this man who had been a cripple from his mother's womb. And we pick up the reading here in Acts chapter 4, verse number 7. And when they had set them in the midst, they asked by what power or by what name, now note that, by what power or by what name have you done this? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said unto them, ye rulers of the people and elders of Israel, if we this day be examined of the good deed done to this impotent man, by what means he is made whole, be it known unto you all and to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doeth this man stand here before you whole. In other words, the man was born crippled, but he got healed in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And this is a stone which was set in naught of you builders, which has become the head of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. There's no other name. And thank God that you have been given access to the use of the name of Jesus. In fact, let me remind you of that fact in the Word of God. In St. Mark, and putting in at verse number 14. Now, this is after Jesus had confirmed to his apostles that he indeed had been raised from the dead. And may I just take a moment and tell you tonight, it is so important, dear hearts, that you know that Jesus has been raised from the dead. Not only did he die, people die all the time. He died and he was dead for 3 days. And on the third day, God the Father raised him from the dead. And this is most crucial. And I have argued this point repeatedly in this ministry because it's so very important. Remember, after Jesus was raised from the dead, he spent 40 days with them, confirming in their hearts because he knew how important it was. He confirmed in their hearts that he was raised from the dead because he was getting ready to give them the power of attorney to go out into the earth to do business on the behalf of the Lord God. And the same thing he's given to us as well. And so I just want to urge you to meditate on the fact that the Lord Jesus Christ not only died, but he rose again. And because the songwriter wrote that song, and because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know that he holds the future. And I know he holds my hand. So tonight, it's in the name of Jesus that you're going to overcome whatever is coming against your life. You're going to overcome it in the name of Jesus. So note he says, now, after he appeared unto the 11 as they sat at meat and upbraided them with their unbelief and hardness of heart, because they believed not them which had seen him after he was risen. And he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and be baptized shall be saved, and he believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils, and they shall speak with new tongues. So this is one of the things that I think the church has been remiss. And I didn't say those people. I said the church, which we all are a part of. I want to encourage you to know that God wants us to begin to use our faith to anticipate or to expect to do the same kind of work that Jesus did by faith in the gospel, by dependency on the power and authority of the Word of God, and the use of the name Jesus, we can do the same work that he did. But I think it's most important for us to begin to prophesy. That you young preachers, why not begin to say that my ministry is going to develop to the level where I'm going to do the same thing Jesus did. I'm going to do the same thing, praise God. And, you know, I pray for our major preachers in America, those who have the big microphones. And the big mic, I mean, those who have exposure to large numbers of people in America. Let's pray for those leading men and women in America today that they would begin to prophesy that they are going to begin to do the same work that Jesus did. That we're going to get out of just explaining God and we're going to begin to move in God. It's one thing to go to seminary to learn how to explain God, but it's another thing to be able to move in God and to see the same kind of powerful manifestation that flowed out of Jesus to flow out of us. I believe by faith that before Jesus returned, that the Church of Jesus Christ is going to be demonstrating the same kinds of healings and the same kind of casting out of demons and getting masses of people healed in the body and seeing miracles and signs and wonders are going to come in the name of Jesus. All God is in need of is for people like you and me who would stand flat foot and declare that it's going to come to pass in the name of Jesus. We're not saved just to get a nice house and to get debt free. No, we're here to use our faith and to develop our faith until we would do the same thing that Jesus did. Note here in St. John chapter 14, putting in at verse, I forgot to tell y'all tonight, I sure love you. I love you and I want you to win. I love you and I want you to overcome every condition. I don't care if you committed a sin 30 minutes ago. I want you to know that you serve a forgiving, merciful God. And they back in the 70s, 80s, they used to preach, he's a God of a second chance. I want you to know he's a God of many chances. Many, many chances. Every time you fall into something, if you confess it before God, he'll be faithful. And just to forgive you and to cleanse you. And I want to encourage you to get up from there and begin to prophesy that your ministry and your lifestyle is going to begin to soar in God. You're not going to stay down. You're getting up from there. Amen. In St. John 14, chapter verse number 12, note here. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me. I love it. This is Jesus speaking right here. He that believeth on me. The works that I do shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. And I've heard theologians and argue about the greater works mean that we'll be on TV and all that stuff. I don't know, that may be the case. But let's just do the basic things. Let's begin to believe God to heal all manner of sickness and disease. What about that? Would you believe that with me? Would you believe God to heal all manner of sickness and disease? Do you believe God can heal COVID-19? Amen to God. Wouldn't it be something? I'm going to change this statement. It's going to be something. When we pastors and preachers get our faith level to the place where we can say, bring all COVID-19 people to us. And just let them just roll them through the church. When they roll, come in sick, they roll out, they're going to get up and be healed in Jesus' name. Now you're talking about bringing in the glory of God. I, for one, believe that God can do just that. But it's going to have to be some people like you and you, dear brother, and you, dear sister, who would join your faith together, who would come into agreement, and began to confess out of your mouth the same thing that Jesus did The church is going to do it again. That is on the way. Let's be frank about it, friends. A lot of people in this country have lost respect for the church. A lot of people in this country today, they'll stand up and they'll say, I believe in science, they say. I believe in science. Whatever the scientists say is what I believe. In other words, they're putting all of their eggs in the science basket. But I want you to know that there's some things that science can study the creation, but they didn't create the creation. Science can study, but they cannot create. I thank and praise God for science. I do also know that science can do things, but may I tell you today that God has more power than the scientists, because the scientists are studying God. Glory to God. And I just want to believe on tonight that in the name of Jesus, that God is going to anoint his church with the same power that Jesus was anointed with. When John the Baptist baptized Jesus in the River Jordan, the Bible says that the Holy Ghost, like a dove, came on Jesus. He was anointed to do what he did by the power of the Holy Ghost. Jesus, listen, Jesus did not do ministry on planet Earth as the Son of God. He did ministry as the Son of Man. What is the difference? He did ministry as a man. Jesus depended on God the Father to lead him. Jesus depended on God the Father to anoint him with the power of the Holy Ghost. He did ministry in the Holy Ghost. Remember what he said in St. Luke chapter 4, verse 18. He said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to heal the brokenhearted. He's anointed me to set at liberty those who bruise. He went on through a litany of the things that the anointing of God was on him to do, to heal the brokenhearted, to heal the wounded spirit, to set the captive free. That's what that anointing is for. And the same anointing that was upon Jesus can also come on you, can also come on me. Let's come together and let's believe together. Let's all speak the same thing. And let's come into agreement that in the name of Jesus, whatever Jesus did, well, by faith we will do the same thing. Verily I say unto you, he that believeth on me, of the works that I do, shall he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go to my Father. And whatsoever you shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. Do you believe that tonight? Well, I encourage you, if you believe that, start praying more. Pray in the name of Jesus. Pray about everything, worry about nothing. Believe that God can fix any condition, any situation, if you use the name of Jesus. You shall go out there, God has said, and use my name. And in my name you shall cast out devils. And in my name you shall get people healed. And in my name you shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. In my name you shall do miracles, signs, and wonders. It's all in the name of Jesus. And that's the name that we're going to have to start using, brother and sisters, if we want to see the favor and blessings of God come up on America on today. In the book of Philippians, and remember, all I'm seeking to do is to encourage you to know that you can use the name of Jesus and get results. That it is God's will that we do his work. And remember, power of attorney. Remember, dear hearts, you're not here just to get blessed. You're not here just to be happy. You're here to do business on the behalf of God. You're here to represent the cause of Christ. So what do we do, beloveds? We discern, or shall I say, we study the scriptures and we observe what Jesus did. And whatever he did, then we can claim we're going to do it too. And we're going to do it because we have been authorized by God. We have the power of attorney. We're in the earth doing business. So we aren't here just to get stuff. Can you imagine going to the military just to get a uniform? Oh, look at my pretty uniform. No, brother, you're a soldier. Thank God for your uniform, but they also teach you how to shoot a weapon. They teach you how to blow up stuff. They teach you how to kill because you are a soldier. Hallelujah to God. You're not in the army to get rich. You're in the army to do business on the behalf of the United States of America. When I went to Vietnam, I was in Vietnam to do business on the behalf of the United States of America. And I want you to know they didn't pay too well either. I needed a raise when I was in there. But the good thing about God, he pays well. When you're doing business on his behalf, whatever your business requires, whatever monies or properties that your business require, he'll give it to you. I'm in a nice building tonight. The business that I was doing for God necessitated that I would have such a property. I need this property to fulfill the call that God has on my life, or shall I say, to do the business on the behalf of God. I had to have this, and how did I get it? I got it in the name of Jesus. The Holy Ghost showed me to get a larger place, and I began to pray in the name of Jesus that God would give it to me. I had to pray in the name of Jesus that God would touch the members to pay their tithe and give liberal offerings. And I mean, some folks are kind of fudging on me a little bit. But I kept on praying. God touched their heart in the name of Jesus. Then I had to pray for the city council and the mayor that God would touch their heart in the name of Jesus. And then I had to pray for the bank that God would touch their heart in the name of Jesus. And it kept on using that name and kept using that name. And it came to pass because guess what? I was doing business on the behalf of God. This is not my property. This property not in Ron Hill's name. This is God's property. And we got it in the name of Jesus. And I want you to know, whatever God has given you to do, you ain't got to try to take somebody else's stuff. You ain't got to try to steal nobody else's members. You don't try to steal nobody else's property. Use the name that is above every name, and that would be the name of Jesus. Because if God give you something to do, then he's going to dial up the power that comes through the name of Jesus. Philippians chapter 2, verse number 5. Let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God also has highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow of the things in heaven and the things in earth and the things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. And that's exactly what is going to happen. Let that mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. He humbled himself and he became obedient. Humble yourself and become obedient, even if you have to die. It's worth it, bro. Hallelujah to God. This is the way Jesus got his name. He got his name through humility. Got his name through obeying God. He had already been given the name, but then he came and lived out the name. He came and fulfilled the call of the name. And now God has highly exalted him. Highly exalted him. And giving him a name. And there's no other name that his name in the universe is higher than the name of Jesus. And just think for a moment. God has authorized you to use that name. Now let's look at Acts chapter 3. And I want you to know tonight that somebody's going to get this tonight. I just believe that somebody's going to view this tonight And they're going to start using the name of Jesus in everything. And they ain't come up, you're going to say, in the name of Jesus. Somebody start talking crazy, in the name of Jesus. Amen. The devil jump on you in the name of Jesus. You better jump off, devil, before you get hurt. Amen. Acts chapter 3, verse 1. Now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour. 3 o'clock in the afternoon, they was going to prayer meeting. By the way, listen, if you want to use that name, use it in prayer. That's the best place to use it, in prayer. And they there they were, and a certain man lame from his mother's womb. And by the way, this man was over 40 years old. He was over 40 years old. He had been lame from his mother's womb, was carried, whom they lay daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered into the temple. He's there begging. Couldn't walk, couldn't work. He was a beggar. Who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked alms. And Peter, fastening his eyes upon him with John, said, "Look on us." And he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something from them. Now, he was going to receive something, but he was going to get more than he expected. He was expected to get some silver. He was expecting to get some gold. So he looked on them, and he was expecting. You know, friends, I know he was expecting gold and silver, but what are you expecting in life tonight? I mean, are you expecting something good to happen in your life? I want to encourage you, hold on to your hope. Don't stop hoping. The moment you stop hoping, you are a danger to yourself. People commit suicide because they lose hope. People walk away from their employment. They walk away from their families. They get divorces. They do all kind of unwise things when they lose their hope. The last thing you want to lose is hope. I know faith is important, but faith doesn't have any work to do if there's no hope. The Bible says faith is the substance of things hoped for. You have to have something you're hoping for. You may be broke, but hope for some money. You may be sick in the body, but hope to be healed. You may be disturbed in your mind. Glory to God, but hope to get some peace in Jesus' name. Hold on to your hope. Those are the three main pillars of life. Faith, hope, and love. They all three need to be activated in your life. If you want to have a balanced life, a winning life, if you want to live a life where you know that no weapons formed against you shall prosper, well, then stay full of faith and maintain your hope and don't stop loving. Don't get mean and don't get cantankerous and don't get critical and negative against people, because when you do, you're going down. I've seen it. I've been watching people since the early 70s in the church, and I've watched people start out real good and then they get bitter against leadership. And then they get bitter against the deacons, and they get bitter against somebody on the job. And next thing you know, that bitterness began to show up in their face, and it began to get into their body, and it begins to corrupt their soul. And the next thing you know, they drive, brother. They lose their joy, and they die without enjoying what God has ordained for them to enjoy. You got to hold on to your hope. Keep on expecting things to get better in your life. The Bible says, and he gave heed unto Peter and John, expecting to receive something of them. Then Peter said, "Silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, you be delivered. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, you be sweet in your soul. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, stop allowing people to get on your nerve. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, stop allowing the president and the mayor and the governor to disturb you. Oh, that's power in that name. And I encourage you to use it on tonight. He said, "Now, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, And immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength. And my God, look at this. And he's leaping up, stood and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. I love this brother. He knew what to do after God had blessed him. After God had blessed him, he knew what he needed to do. Do you have enough insight to know what you need to do after God has done something for you? When God does something for you, it's time to praise him. It's time to leap and jump and run and magnify God. This man was up walking, leaping, and praising God. And by the way, he had never walked before. So God not only healed him, but taught him how to walk simultaneously. Why, if you get in a sick condition or have an accident and you're unable to walk for several years, you have to go to therapy. You have to go to a place where they teach you how to walk again. So this man had never walked before. But yet there he is walking, not only walking, but he's leaping and giving God the praise. Why? Because of the power that was released in his body in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I'm trying to encourage you to know tonight that in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, you can be healed in your body. Yes, you can. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, you can be delivered from the hands of the devil, even tonight. And then the Bible says, and they knew that it was he which was set for alms at the beautiful gate of the temple. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at that which had happened unto him. And they were saying, I wonder what happened. I'm amazed. Did you see the man who's been sitting out in front of that gate for years? And now there he is running, walking, leaping, and praising God. They were flabbergasted. They were like, what is going on? And as the lame man, which was healed, he's not lame anymore. And as the man who was lame was healed, hailed Peter and John. All the people ran together unto them in the porch that is called Solomon, greatly wondering. And when Peter saw it, he answered unto the people, ye men of Israel, why marvel ye at this? Or why look ye so earnestly on us, as though by our own power or holiness we had made this man to walk? In other words, don't come praising us as the preacher. And I will say to preachers tonight, stop trying to be great preachers. Be faithful preachers. Stop trying to bring attention to yourself. Give all the glory to God. Now, Peter and John could have very easily said, okay, now we're going to become the bishops over this area, and we want an appreciation every year, and we want you to bring us your money, and when we come in, stand to your feet. Because here we come, the great wonder, Peter and John. Remember us, we're the people that got this man healed. We are holy men, and we are righteous, and we are glorious men. No, they didn't do that. They didn't do that. The Bible says, and when Peter saw it, when they came running to him, he answered unto the people, ye men of Israel, why marvel ye at this? Or why look ye so earnestly on us, as though by our own power or holiness, we have made this man to walk? The God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob, the God of our fathers, has glorified his son Jesus. What has he done? He's glorified his son Jesus. Am I talking to anybody today, tonight, who would like to see Jesus glorified? I would. It is my prayer, Father, use this ministry so that you can be glorified, so you can be honored. I want the world to know the reality of Jesus. There are people out there who are trusting science and think that God is not real. They think that Christians are a bunch of weak, ignorant people, and they think that we're a bunch of nuts. And why? Because they haven't seen enough of God's glory in this country. We need to see the manifestation of God's glory. We don't need any more slick preachers. We don't need any more silver tongue orators. We don't need any more wordsmiths who can just speak so eloquently and everybody's amazed about how well they speak. It's not about how well you speak, preacher. Do you have the corresponding power to confirm that what you are speaking is coming from God? Are you anointed with the glory and power of the Holy Ghost? This is what we need. Remember, Peter and John were in the upper room on the day of Pentecost. These brothers had not only been confirmed in their minds that Jesus had been raised from the dead, not only were they confirmed that he was alive, but they had gotten baptized and filled with the Holy Ghost. And so now they have both information and inspiration. They had the knowledge of the word, but they had the impartation of the fire and glory of the Holy Ghost. And that's what's going to happen in our church. We're going to see the release of the anointing of God. And God's going to heal people. Signs and wonders are coming, and they're coming in the name of Jesus. They're not going to come because of some great preacher. They're not going to come because you yell loud, and they're not going to come because you act weird. No, the glory of God's going to come when we begin to, by faith, use this name of Jesus, the God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob. The God of our Father has glorified his Son Jesus, whom ye delivered up and denied him in the presence of Pilate when he was determined to let him go. But ye denied the Holy One and the just and desired a murderer to be granted unto you, and killed the Prince of Life, whom God has raised from the dead, where we are witnesses. And his name, through faith in his name. Did you hear what he said? Verse 16. And his name, through faith in his name, has made this man strong, whom you see and know. Yea, the faith which is by him has given him this perfect soundness in the presence of you all. It was all in the name of Jesus. And finally, my brother and sister, in John chapter 20, verse 31. I hope you've enjoyed this word tonight. And I want you to know tonight, praise the Lord, that you can have life through this name, brother. Hey, sister, hey, husband, hey, wife. You got some issues in your life you don't like, use the name of Jesus and change it. Change it in the name of Jesus. Amen to God. Believe God to release his glory in your life, in the name of Jesus. Let's get our faith together and begin to say, in the name of Jesus, something good is going to happen in our lives. Let's believe God that the Holy Ghost is going to reveal himself to the people of God. In my private prayer time today, I came across a verse and it blessed me. It's in your reading if you read today. It's in Acts. And in the book of Acts, it said that there was a woman that God gave her, paraphrasing, God gave her the capacity to believe. God can illuminate our hearts. He can enlarge our hearts and give us the ability to see him in the Holy Ghost. He can't make us obey him, but he can shine on us. He couldn't make the Saul of Tarsus, he could make Saul of Tarsus obey him, but he could send a light brighter than the noonday sun, and he could knock Saul off his beast and put him on the ground and begin to talk to him. And then Saul wanted to know, well, who are you, Lord? He said, I'm Jesus whom you're persecuting. It's hard for you to kick against the prick. And that man was changed from that moment. And let's believe God that there would be a spiritual epiphany for somebody tonight, that the Holy Ghost would reveal himself in such a fashion that there would be no doubt in your mind about the legitimacy of the Bible. See, some of us need that. Some of us have been following after Jesus our mother talked about or that we read about. But God is wanting to make himself known to you in a personal way. And it's going to happen through the power of the name of Jesus. Finally, in St. John chapter 20, verses number 30 and 31. And many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written that ye might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing ye might have life through his name. Did you catch that tonight? Excuse me. I love it so much. I want to read it one more time, brother. Come on, sister. I want you to get this tonight. And many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples. In other words, Jesus repeatedly did things in the presence of his disciples to give them experience and to give them the assurance that I'm God. In other words, I'm going to take a few fish and a few loaves of bread, and I'm going to feed 5,000 men plus the women and the children. And we're going to have food left over because I want you to know that I'm God. Oh, yes, I'm on the back of this boat, sleep. There's a raging storm out there. The boat is taking on water. It may look like you're getting ready to go under, but I'm allowing this to happen so I can demonstrate my power. And he got up and rebuked the wind and the waves, and they obeyed him. What was he doing? He was confirming in their hearts, I'm God. Excuse me. Your life may be taken on water tonight. Yes. You may be in a situation where it appears that you're not going to come out of it. But Jesus is still on board. And as long as he's with you, you ain't dying until God says so. You're not going anywhere until God gives his approval. So instead of getting into fear and anxiety, get off into faith. Have faith in God. Have dependency on the name that is of above, that is above every name, that would be the name of Jesus. Haven't you gotten things done before in that name? Well, it'll work again, brother and sister. Just use it. And the Bible says, and many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written that ye might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing ye might have life through his name. It's in the name of Jesus. Salvation is in the name of Jesus. Your healing is in the name of Jesus. Your marriage can be turned around in a positive way in the name of Jesus. Oh, child of God, please don't quit. Don't give up. I know it may be tough, but there is victory in the name of Jesus. Oh, God, tonight, I pray in Jesus' name for everybody who's viewing tonight. Whatever the need is in your life, please know that in the name of Jesus, you're going to come out more than a conqueror. Life is going to change for you. And let me say this to you once again. In this ministry, let us begin to believe God for the same kinds of ministry, the same kind of ministry that Jesus had. I want to see it in the house of God. In Jesus' name. Father, tonight, I thank you for allowing me to be a minister to these, your wonderful people. I know you love them. And I know that you want to bless their lives. And I know that you're trying to use me to speak a word and to be an example to them, that they'll know that there's hope in you. So I pray for every brother, every sister tonight. Illuminate their hearts, and may they get free from all anger and fear and hatred and unforgiveness. May they get full of love and full of holiness and power. May they pay their tithe and give liberal offerings. May they be blessed financially, materialistically, and may they be full of your love. In Jesus' name. And we bless the Lord. Oh, my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy, holy name. Bless his name. Thank you, Jesus. For he has done great things. Hallelujah. Christ has done great things. He has done great things. Bless his holy name. God bless you this evening. I pray that God would touch your body and heal your body and your soul tonight. I pray the blessings of God upon your marriage, upon your children. I pray that whatever your need is tonight, that God the Father would meet that need in the name of Jesus. Don't quit. Don't give up. Hold on. We're looking forward to having watch night service. I know all of you don't want to come, but we're going to come out here at 10 o'clock on New Year's Eve and just do what God give us to do. You're welcome to come. We're going to have social distances, and we're going to have our masks on and hand sanitizers, and we're going to check temperature and the whole bit. But let's believe God. Amen. Because he's the only living God. I said that he's the only living God. Yes, Lord, yes, Lord. And we love him. We adore him. Magnify him. Glorify him. Because he's the only living God. Well, God bless you. My time is out. I need you to please stand with your ministry. If you're a member, you know that we have responsibilities financially. And I'm asking you to please be honest with God and pay your tithe and give liberal offerings. And if you are a guest, we're asking you as well. If you've been ministered to by the ministry, I think it's no more than right that you too stand with the ministry with your prayers and a financial gift. And before I go off tonight, please pray for my dear friend, Bishop Bob Jackson's wife. Barbara Jackson has contracted COVID-19, and she's in the hospital while I speak tonight. Please, sir, and please, ma'am, remember Barbara Jackson and ask God to bring her out of COVID-19. Father, we want to pray tonight for Bishop Bob Jackson and for his wife, Barbara Jackson, that you bring healing to the Jackson family. Oh, God, by the stripes of Jesus, we're healed. We set ourselves in agreement tonight for Barbara Jackson. Bring her out. We pray you heal her in Jesus' name. And all the members of Love and Unity who have been attracted and has contracted COVID-19, God, heal their body as well in Jesus' name. And thank you for the tithe and offerings tonight. And I pray that the members will stay faithful in reading their Bibles, fasting and praying, and reading their Bibles. I love you tonight. Be blessed.
Thank you for attending Loving Unity Christian Fellowship on today. We would like you to participate in this time of worship and giving. You can utilize Text to Give, Ministry One app, or go to loveandunity.org. If you would like to text, please text the word GIVE to 310-507-1181. or you can use our new Church Ministry One app by going to your Play Store and ordering Ministry One app. It's free. Or go to loveandunity.org, loveandunity.org, and you can give there. Thank you so much again for joining us here at Love and Unity Christian Fellowship. You're going to have a good time.